So, hi everybody. I'm going to a talk on scalable continuous integration and continuous delivery with Jenkins and Nomad. I actually published a blog post on this last week, and I'm kind of curious who has already seen it or read it.
Seen it, yes, read it, no.
Okay, so that's both good and bad, because it's good that I'm going to tell you something new, and bad that social media apparently isn't working at all.
It's on the meetup group, or where did you post it?
Oh, it was on Twitter. I should have retweeted it. And it was in DevOps Weekly as well.
Don't follow the right.
Hacking news. So anyway, let's continue. So about me, I'm a consultant at CBA. I'm mainly involved in data center automation and developing infrastructure to optimize the software delivery pipeline. So anything from the continuous integration platform to metrics, logging, container-based platforms, all that kind of good stuff. I'm mostly on the ops side of things, but I'm also been a programmer for most of my life, so really passionate about open source actually. I think it's really nice that we get to use all these great tools and learn from it and collaborate on it, so I think that's really cool. For the Nomad project actually, it was launched in September last year by HashiCorp. And I've been following it and been actively contributing to it as well. And recently became a committer on the Nomad project, so I think that's really cool. And you can find me on Twitter and on my GitHub as well. So, the two main characters of this story, if you will, Jenkins and Nomad. I'm going to assume for a little bit that you all know what Jenkins is and what it can do, which is basically anything you want. Nomad is maybe the lesser known tool here. Who has heard of Nomad? Who has actually sort of ran the Nomad in it and run example? Okay. Anyone using it in production already? Oh, come on, it's 0.3 version.
0.2.
So yeah, what is Nomad? It is a cluster manager and scheduler, but what does that actually mean? So the cluster manager part is about that you're going to run Nomad on a number of machines, and you're going to install the agent on it, and the agent is in fact going to fingerprint the node and see what kind of resources are available and what kind of information that is specific to that node is available. And it's going to use that to aggregate all the resources together and give you a sort of a pool of resources that you can use to schedule your workloads with Nomad. And the scheduling part is actually the part that takes your job definition, as we will see in a bit. It's a declarative format where you specify what workload you want to run. And the scheduler is actually going to determine where it's going to place that workload. So given what it knows about the cluster, it's going to first filter out all the nodes that aren't capable of running your workload because you've set constraints or there are not enough resources. And the scheduler, the next part is the algorithm itself that is going to determine the best fit. So where's your workload best placed in the cluster so that you get optimal resource usage. It's called bin packing, and it's basically trying to fit as much workloads on one machine as it possibly can to optimize the resources. So what makes Nomad unique? Like I said, they announced it last year in September, thereabouts. And projects like Kubernetes and Mesos were already well on the way to very popular projects that can do the same as Nomad. So why did they decide to create a scheduler of their own? HashiCorp being HashiCorp, they've given this some thought. It's actually on the website as well, where they compare Nomad to Kubernetes, Mesos, and other systems that do basically the same, but I want to highlight a couple of things. So it's operationally very simple to manage and to deploy. Like most of the HashiCorp tools, it's built in Go, and it actually compiles down to one binary. And the one binary is all you need on the node. You need to deploy it to the node, you give it some configuration, and then it's basically going to start in either a server mode or in a client mode. You need the server modes to get the highly available cluster where your state is highly available, and if you run it as a client, it is basically capable of running your workloads, and it's going to start up your Docker containers or whatever you want. So that's really nice. There's also no need for additional infrastructure to be in place. So maybe with if you use something like Mesos and Marathon, well, there it's split. Mesos is the cluster manager, and Marathon is the scheduler. But you also need to run a zookeeper for Mesos. For Kubernetes, I believe you have to run etcd. And the Nomad is all contained in the one binary. So you get you don't have to do anything else, and it will basically work, which is very nice. It's really flexible. It's really differentiates itself from other similar systems in this way. It has a notion of task drivers. So a task driver is basically a mechanism that you can start different kinds of workloads. It has Docker, a Docker driver where you can run your containers. It also has a Java driver where you can run your Java artifacts like jars and wars. There's Kemu, a virtualization tool, so you can actually schedule virtual machines if you wanted to. On top of that, it has an exec, just a raw exec. And the raw exec is only if you don't want to contain it, isolate it from the other workloads, and it's not really recommended to use it. It's there if you want it. And it's also cross-platform, so that's really nice. You can run it on Linux, but you can also run it on Windows or OS X. So that is really a really neat property. And it's built for scale. It has a notion of regions, like the US or Europe. Within the regions you have data centers, you can have multiple data centers, and you can use this information in your job definition to really constrict a job to only run in a specific geographic area that you want. And that it's built for scale is also apparent in the scheduling algorithm that it uses. So with most systems, there's only one server actually doing the scheduling decision. So it's getting the job definition, and it's going to determine where to place the node. Usually this is done on a single server, but Nomad actually utilizes all the servers for this. So the amount of scheduling or the speed of scheduling is much higher than in other systems, which really scales. And maybe you've heard of this. They did a 1 million container scheduling test. So they spun up 5,000 nodes in a cloud platform, and they just scheduled 1 million containers on them, and they wanted to see how it works. And this is basically the graph. You can see that it scales almost linearly. So in less than 5 minutes, all the containers were scheduled on the 5,000 nodes, which really proves that the approach that they've taken really scales well to whatever size you need.
Single data center.
They spun up the 5,000 nodes on the cloud platform. I'm not sure which one.
Google.
That one.
What do those three lines mean? You've got scheduled receiving.
Yeah, so the orange line is actually the scheduling. So this represents when the decision is being made. So that the scheduler has determined where it will place the workload. Okay. The light blue line is where the client has actually received the command to start the workload. And the dark blue line is where the workload is actually up and running.
Why is the divergence at the end so getting more pronounced, or is it an artifact?
I'm really not sure, actually. Okay. I do remember that they had to restart, workloads and 100,000 or something like that. They had to restart them to actually get to 1 million. So maybe that's what the... So that's all good and nice, but I wanted to do a real life use case with this. Maybe you don't want to run your production workloads with this system yet, but I thought continuous integration and continuous delivery might be a good use case to find out what Nomad is capable of. So over the last couple of weeks I've been experimenting with this, and this actually resulted in the setup that I'm about to show you. It's this picture. Like I said, these are the resources that Nomad is going to utilize to schedule the workloads. This big square is the whole pool of resources. And you could sort of partition it in a static part of the platform and a dynamic part of the platform. The static part of the platform is running long-term services that you always want running in your platform, like a Selenium hub that's responsible for coordinating the Selenium browser nodes. You want a Docker registry to store your Docker containers. You want a Jenkins master to start your workloads. And you want control for service discovery, but because with a scheduler, you're not going to know upfront where your workload is going to run, so you need a central mechanism to find out where they are. Mm-hmm. And then you have the dynamic part, which is being scaled up and down depending on workload. So you have the Selenium browser nodes, which can be scheduled and unscheduled, build slaves for Jenkins, and you can run multiple environments of your application. So you could have an integration and test acceptance environment. And this is all running within the same Nomad cluster. So the lines here are actually just logical separations within the cluster. So this is what I set out to build, what I want to show you guys. So the next part will be, small disclaimer. This is a proof of concept. It all works, but to really make it production ready, you will need to scale it out and set up multiple servers. So what I have is a vagrant machine, and I've already started the vagrant machine. And I've also bootstrapped the vagrant machine. And I'll show you the vagrant file that's actually responsible for this. So when the vagrant machine boots up, it's going to download Nomad from the releases page, and it's going to start it as a daemon within the vagrant machine and with this configuration. And it actually, for this purpose, it has a really nice feature that you can run it in dev mode, which means it will start up as a server and as a client at the same time. So that way you can experiment with it rather quickly, which is really nice. It's also fetching console, and Nomad is actually going to start console for us. I will show the job definition right now. So Nomad really is the only interface and one entry point to scheduling workloads on the cluster. Going to run separate services yourself. It's all done through Nomad. I'm also using a couple of configuration files. The DNS mask is necessary to redirect console DNS queries to console and other queries to Google DNS service in this case. And the Docker daemon config is configured to allow pushes to an insecure registry, which I'm running within the Nomad cluster. Oh yeah, and I'm also making it available through the through a TCP port on the host, which I will go into a little bit. So, if you look at what we have running right now, we have console running and it knows about these services right now. So Docker and Nomad are actually pointing to it's all pointing to the same virtual machine, but we can use these definitions for our DNS queries. So, to show you how the console definition for a job looks like, it's like this. And the interesting bit is right at the top. The type is system. So Nomad has different kinds of scheduling mechanisms. It has the system, a service, and a batch. And they all serve a different purpose. In this case, system will make sure that this workload is actually going to be scheduled on each node that is within the cluster. So if you have system jobs like console, where you want to run an agent on every node, you can use the system scheduler to get it on every node. The batch scheduler is more for one-off jobs. We'll see that used with the Jenkins slaves, which are being spun up. They run their workload and they're being discarded. Ideal use case for the batch. And the services for the long-running services like console for the Docker registry I'm using that for. It's really going to try and keep those services up. So I'm not going to go into great detail in the job definition. Mons actually did a nice introduction on Nomad, I believe, 2 meetups ago.
Yeah.
So it's online as well, so I encourage you to go and look at it. Or at the documentation, it's really nicely documented. Here you can see the command for console, which I'm starting with. Again, the dev mode for console. Like I said, I'm taking some shortcuts here in the production ready setup. it's quite convenient. And another nice thing about Nomad is that it directly integrates with console. So you do not need to run a separate process like registrator or something like that to get your services registered into console. So if Nomad schedules this workload, it will also add an entry to console, which is really nice. And this is the service block that defines what is going to be put into console. This is also a very important part. If you are using a scheduler, you really have to make sure that you tell the scheduler what kind of resources you need, because otherwise it's going to have a hard time bin packing all the workloads on the node. So I'm giving it 300 megahertz in this case. Nomad is the unit of CPU is megahertz, megabyte. The CPU is actually a soft limit, but the memory is a hard limit. So if your processor tries to acquire more than that memory, it's going to get killed by well, in this case by the isolated CPUs. Networking, and if you want to expose ports. In this case, I'm exposing static ports, 8600 and 8500. For dynamic workloads, the scheduler is going to determine the port for us, actually. That's not known before. So, let me see. Well, now that Nomad is up and running, console is up and running, we need something else. We need a service, of a Docker registry. So let's start it up. I've created some convenience scripts. Show you the contents, but we can start it. So what this is doing is really simple actually. It's going to SSH into the vagrant box and it's going to run a command. And what it's going to run is Nomad. It's going to give Nomad the registry.nomad job definition, which I can show you real quick. But it's more or less the same as the console one. So, but in this case, I'm using the service scheduler. So this is going to, Nomad is going to try its utmost to keep the service up and running. And this is actually using a Docker driver. The console was using the exec driver. So it's scheduling the binary within a CH root and the C root. It's actually isolating the process just like Docker is doing. But it's just running a command, and in this case we're leveraging Docker to start the registry for us. So we have the configuration, we use the registry image, and we are again mapping port 5000 to a static port in the cluster. So we should have a registry running at this point. What we're also going to start is the Selenium hub. Are you familiar with Selenium, how it works? So we have one hub, a sort of coordination point where you can run your Selenium tests against, and that hub is going to leverage a Selenium node that could be running a Firefox browser or a Chrome browser or a Windows browser. It's going to redirect the tests to a particular node depending on what kind of browser you want. So this should be up and running now as well. So this is all done through Nomad. Nomad is all scheduling this all. So we can now start going to start our Jenkins master to have our jobs. But before we do that, we have to actually build it. So we have to configure the Jenkins image, if you will. So I'm using a template for that. So I'm just pulling. Oh, you can see this. I'm pulling from the Jenkins image on the Docker registry, the Docker hub. I'm copying my home directory into the reference directory. It's going to use that to when it starts up. It's going to load the job definitions and the plugin definitions and all kinds of configuration. I'm also installing a couple of plugins which I need for the jobs. One of them is actually going to be the Nomad plugin to have Jenkins talk to Nomad directly. I'm going to install JQ, which is a JSON parser for the command line. So let's build this. This is again going to run in the vagrant machine. I'm using a cached version of all the from the Docker file, since I've already I ran it beforehand, so it would speed things up a little bit. This pushing is actually being done to the local registry in the cluster at this point. Might be good to know that the registry is not using a volume right now, and that is because Nomad does not support volumes at this point. So that is kind of a blocker for most people right now. But with the next version that is coming out, 0.4, there should be volume support in there. So you do not have to rebuild your images all the time. OK, so now we built the Jenkins master image. And I'm going to ask Nomad to schedule this for me to start it up. So again, same thing. And right now, we are going to hopefully see Jenkins. Might be good to show you guys what I did to get this configuration running. This directory that you see here, the contents of this is copied into the Docker container from Jenkins, and when it boots up, it's going to read this config.xml for its main configuration of Jenkins. It's going to use the jobs for all the jobs that I need for building the application that I'm about to show you, and for deploying it and for running integration tests. I pre-configured this beforehand and exported it so that I could use it here. You could use something like the job DSL as well, which would be quite convenient. And there's a list of plugins that I want installed in my master. As you can see, some critical plugins like Greenballs and Chuck Norris are missing, so pull requests are accepted. So I have a Jenkins up and running. These are the jobs that I pre-configured, and I want to show you the configuration of Jenkins actually right now. So Jenkins and Nomad need to work together. And in order to do this, I wrote a plugin for Jenkins that is actually going to take a configuration for slave templates, and it's going to talk to Nomad to schedule these slaves for us. They could be, it could be a plain Java, just starting up the Java slave jar, or in this case, I'm going to use a container to do my build. I will show you an application that I've created for this purpose, for a demo, that is actually providing a build image for us that Jenkins can use to schedule build slaves. So I'll quickly go over it. You define a name for the cloud. Jenkins has the concept of cloud plugins. You could use AWS or VMware or DigitalOcean, whatever. There's also a plugin for Mesos. Well, in this case, it's for Nomad. You need to specify where it can contact Nomad, and I'm doing this through console, and letting it resolve where Nomad is. The Jenkins base URLs, and where it can find the slave jar. And the slave jar is actually the process that gets started by Jenkins, which will connect back to the master, and then will then be available as a slave to schedule builds on. This is actually quite interesting. You can specify different slave templates. So what we just saw for the resources, you could use, you can specify the amount of CPU you want to give this build slave, the amount of memory. Very important, you have to give it a set of labels so that you can restrict your jobs to only run on this particular slave and not on another one where build dependencies might be missing. So disk, global, these are basically the Nomad things that you can put in the job specification. And the workspace root for the Jenkins build, where it's going to run its build. I'm going to build a Golang application, so I need it to be in /go. And here I'm actually specifying which image to use. We haven't created it yet, but I will show you in a minute that the application actually provides a build container or a build image for us, which we're going to use to run the builds. everybody with me so far? I know it's a lot to take in.
Yeah, it's going pretty fast, but the one thing that I didn't follow is how does your DNS work? You have all these magic names, like this nomad-ci, which are not just like the
other. Oh, sorry, yeah, okay. So the one in the browser, that's just in my host file on the local system. There's an entry to a particular IP address of the VegaBox.
So yeah, and the same holds for the configuration you just sent us, where it does something.console.
Right. So what I'm using
I
here.
Saw a lot more.
So you will see a lot of these kinds of URLs that end in .service.console. And what is actually happening in the Vagrant box here? I'm running a DNS mask daemon, and that daemon is going to it's acting as a DNS server, and it's going to filter out the requests for service.console, and it's going to redirect them to the console application, which provides a DNS interface for the services that it knows about. So if you run jenkins-master.service.console, it's going to ask console, hey, do you know about this service? Okay, if you know about it, give me the DNS record for where I can find it, and you get the IP address back. Or if you use service record, you also get the port back, which is really nice. Everything that does not end in service.console is going to be redirected to the Google DNS service. So that is... okay. So only one thing left to do before we can actually start building our application, and that is getting a build container that contains all the dependencies that I need to run my builds. In this case, we need a Golang compiler in there, and we need some NPM modules for the integration test. So let's do this now. So I've created a small demo application. What it is actually going to do is generate a string. Hello, my name is and a name, and I'm 8 years old, and I live in the door environment. This is all it does. It's pretty awesome, right? The name is actually going to come from a different service. So I have a different service that is going to randomly generate names. For the micro app application, and I have a different service that's going to be responsible for generating ages for the string. And this is a different service. This is a different service. It's also using Redis. You can store the generated string, and then it will keep using that string until you clear it from the cache. It's just a basic demo setup to have different services and seeing how they work together as an environment. The micro app is sort of the main application, and if that boots up in the container, it's actually going to use console template to ask console, hey, where are these services? Where is my name service? Where is my age service? Where is my Redis server? And it's going to write that into a config file, and then the micro app boots up, and then it will know where to look for these services, and it's going to send a request to their APIs to get the information that it needs.
So is that static in the config file, or is it using the dynamic information?
It's using the dynamic information, but it's kind of a shortcut because it's only going to query console for the information at start, and it's going to write the config file, and then it's going to start the micro application. So once this is written, it will not...
So it's sort of static. Yeah. If you change any of these services on the back end?
Yes and no. What it will do is actually write the DNS names into the config file, but they will be specific to a environment. Like I said in the picture, you can schedule different environments of the same application, and we need somehow to differentiate, well, this is the test environment, this is the integration, and that is what this is responsible for. But should one of the services be rescheduled on another node, then it will resolve them
to another IP address.
Yeah. Okay, so that is the basic application. What it needs is a Jenkins slave to build it, and it looks like this. It's actually pretty simple. I'm taking the Golang image from the Docker registry. It contains the compiler toolchain that I need. It's going to insert Docker, because we're going to need Docker to talk to the host system to schedule or to push our images, basically. And it's going to install some packages that I need. Java for the Jenkins slave. It needs Java to run the Jenkins slave. And I need Node.js to run my integration tests, which we will see later. So let's build that as well. Again, the same process is going to into the variant box. It's using cached entries right now. It's quite a big image, actually, the Golang image. I think it's about 600 megabytes already, so it's pretty big. But if you need less or you want to build your own image for Golang, which is perfectly feasible, then you can probably reduce the image size quite a bit. So I have to wait until this is finished. So once this is finished, we actually have a container image that Jenkins can use to run its build. I can show you. So let's take a look at how it's building this. So here you see the restriction, Nomad and Golang. This is what makes this build only run on the slave template that we've defined in the management in the Jenkins configuration. It's going to basically pull my repository, build from the master branch. And it's going to simply call a build.sh script that is in my repository, which takes care of all the running the tests, running the builds, and actually creating a Docker image for this component and pushing it to the registry. So this should be finished now, I think. Yeah. Okay. So let's see what happens. I have a build job here, which is actually going to start all three builds at the same time. So, it's in the build queue, and you can already see that an additional slave is being spun up by Jenkins. So this is Jenkins talking through to the Nomad API. I need an additional build slave. I have workload that I need to get rid of. Can you schedule a build slave for me? So this is also being run in the Nomad cluster as well. And depending on how Jenkins assesses the workload, it will actually schedule multiple slaves. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. I'm not really sure why, but if you have a build queue filling up, it will definitely start adding additional slaves to get rid of the workload.
Does it kill the build slaves too?
Yes, it does. And it's also configurable in the configuration. I think I've set it to 1 minute, or it's 5 minutes by default or something like that. And the build slave will be gone.
Like actually scheduling
single
instances, or like spun up?
Yeah, so Jenkins is going to, through the API, going to talk to Nomad for, well, give me an additional slave, and it's also going to talk to Nomad to kill the slave.
But can it spin up
virtual
servers in like Amazon or something? So,
okay, no, then you would use the AWS plugin for Jenkins. That can actually talk to the Amazon API and schedule for
it. So Nomad doesn't.
No, you could use the Camu, I don't know how to pronounce it, but it's a virtualization tool where you can actually schedule virtual machines. But that doesn't work so well if you're already running on a hypervisor. So if you can't really use it in the cloud. So, but if you have hardware in a data center, you could definitely use it to schedule virtual machines as well. Okay, so it looks like all my builds succeeded. So now I have Docker images for my aid server, my MicroApp servers, my name servers, and it is at this point that we can actually deploy it. We have a job for this as well. So like I said, we can have multiple environments of the same application. In this case, I'm going to deploy it to the test environment. I need to show this. So what is happening now is that the Jenkins is actually, so this is the repository for my this is the repository for the application. Main.go is the micro app, and services are the name and the aid servers. In support there's the Jenkins slave configuration. Integration test we'll see in a bit. But the deploy directory, that's actually what is being used right now by Jenkins. And again, you define a number of jobs that you want Nomad to run. So in this case, it's going to spin up the aid service, the micro service, name service, and Redis. And there's a little bit of logic here to, these are actually templates. I'm substituting the environment that I passed as a parameter in the Jenkins job. I'm substituting that in the job definitions so that these components get namespaced basically within an environment so that you don't get the cross-contamination that the components in a test environment are going to talk to an acceptance environment or an integration.
I have another question. These environments, do they simply start to exist if you name them in this build job or are they predefined?
No, they start to exist once you... So I can put anything in there and it will spin up a complete new stack with all the components within the cluster. Unfortunately, my virtual machine is only 4 or 5 gigabytes, so I won't be able to, with all the other services that are actually already running on the VM, I'm not able to spin up multiple environments, but you could if you want. So, yeah, it looks like what you've seen. And I'm only substituting the environments here to do a namespacing. It's a bit crude, but it works for my use case. So it ran the deploy job, and now it's actually telling me, hey, you have a new environment. I could just use the port. So here we are. Yeah, like I said, awesome. An introduction, which is different every time, but if I hear and the score is true, and it's basically going to keep it. It's now stored in Redis. I want to clear it. It's just for demo purposes, so to see that all the servers are actually working together within that environment. So the last step that I'm going to show you is actually running an integration test. So I want to test if this introduction is actually being generated correctly. I'm going to do this through Selenium, the Selenium test. It's actually going to talk to a browser. It's going to run the application in an integration environment, load it in a browser, and test if the output is according to a regular expression that I've set in my test. So, but first I need to stop the environment because, like I said, I don't have enough resources. You can actually see it here now in console. These are the containers that were spun up. And these should now start disappearing.
So you have these jobs, Jenkins. You store them somewhere separately and you inject them when you start with Jenkins.
Oh, you mean the Jenkins jobs itself?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've pre-configured them and they're actually in a directory with XML files, the configuration for the jobs. And I've put them into the Jenkins master container, and when it starts up, it knows that it has to look there for the configuration.
Yeah. And if you would want to add a job, how much work would that be?
That's quite a hassle. Yeah. You have to sort of configure it manually and then export it, like I've done with these jobs. Better option would be to use the job DSL and just configure your jobs there. And
what we did is we all everything we put into Ansible, and Jenkins only kicks off the Ansible script. Readable.
Yeah, okay. Makes sense, yeah. This is really, really crude. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Again, for demo. So the platform is stopped right now, and what I actually want to show you last is an integration test. Let me get back to the... So I have integration tests, so... And it looks like this. So, since Nomad is available in the cluster, why not use it? You can let Jenkins talk to Nomad, but you can talk to Nomad yourself as well, just by posting a JSON definition of the job to the Nomad API, and it will start up whatever you specify. And in this case, I want to run a Selenium container, which is running the Chrome browser, and one that is running the Firefox browser. So I'm going to first ask it to schedule that onto the cluster. Then I'm going, by the same logic, I'm going to spin up an integration environment. So like we just did with the test environment, this is going to do the integration environment, and it's going to install npm. this is kind of a hack. I need to insert.
Chai.
Chai. It's a framework, Node.js framework for running assertions on Selenium. I'm using the WebDriver IO package. What I do need for this test to succeed is I need the base URL of the integration environment. I need to know where it is. On which port is the micro app actually running in the integration environment? And that's what I'm doing here. So I'm asking console, hey, where is this micro app integration environment? And then I'm parsing the JSON output to give me basically the URL. I'm substituting that in the configuration. Again, it works. So I need some additional time to let I've already downloaded the container images for the Selenium, but normally it would take some time for them to download. So I'm done running the tests, and after the tests have run, I'm stopping the Selenium nodes again, and I'm stopping the environment. So this should totally clear up the entire integration environment. So let's see if this works. This will require the build slave. Again, because I've installed Node.js and some packages that it needs to run the test. You should see some integration environments appearing, and here are the Selenium and Firefox nodes. This is the last one, actually, microwave. So we already have a running environment right now, which is at this port. So it's now in the sleep, which is not really necessary now because I've pre-downloaded the images, but normally you need this time for it to spin up. A good time to show this as well. So this is the Selenium hub, and it's quite busy. Actually already finished. So what you see here is that it's running the integration test. It wrote a XUnit report and two tests are passing. So that means that the application was tested okay. No more integration environments, hold on. You can see the latest test results here if you want to see what it did. So yeah, that is basically the setup that I wanted to show you. A couple more slides. So we did it. So like I said, it's a proof of concept. So where to go next? Well, first of all, of course, make it highly available. Running within one Vega machine is nice for demo purposes, but if you really want to use this as a production setup, you should at least use three servers to have a highly available Nomad cluster. Maybe even use a cloud setup where you automatically scale your worker nodes to distribute the Jenkins jobs to. Then build a better networking model. It's all kind of simplistic, talking directly to console to get the locations. Maybe you want have some load balancers in there to if you have multiple components running to redirect the network traffic, and evolve the Jenkins Nomad plugin a little bit more. It's a first version. I'd like some help on it, so whoever has wants to do it, and just let me know. We can add extra features to it. So last slide, almost the last slide. I wanted to point out the HashiConf Europe conference. We're actually co-organizing that with HashiCorp. It's in Amsterdam. It's going to be all about Nomad and setups like this, and really interesting talk. So if you're interested, please join us. It will be really, really awesome. And with that, I'd like to thank you. Any questions? Yeah.
Yeah. In the early stage of the talk, you said that you don't want to use Nomad yet for production. So, in your opinion, what is the besides the volume issue with it, which I think it's a big topic. But besides that, what do you think that Nomad is missing before it becomes production ready?
Actually, you might not want to use it in production yet. Like you said, the volumes is the biggest blocker. HashiCorp is actually using Nomad for their internal infrastructure already, so they're using it in production. I don't think at this point there really is a blocker to using it in production other than the volumes. You don't have the nice maybe GUI like Marathon has or Kubernetes has. Maybe a little bit more user friendly. This is a little bit more low level. But there are no real blockers to not start using Nomad to do the workloads. It's actually really capable of doing it already.
Are you going to be speaking at the HashiConf?
No, colleagues of mine. But we will be trying to build this out in a highly distributed, highly available manner on the cloud platform. So that might be the next iteration of this platform. We'll see how that goes. Yeah.
This is a demo. What would be a real life use case for this setup?
This is a demo, but if you build it out to be highly available, then I think you could use it right away. Or are you targeting something specific that you are missing right now?
No, not really. Just something. Yeah, I couldn't picture something that I. How can I use this in real life?
Well, are you using? Do you have a continuous integration process right now?
Personally, yes.
Okay, so normally you would already have this sort of in place, either with Jenkins or another continuous integration tool. And you either have it statically configured to run on a couple of nodes, maybe you have some slaves that you have configured. That'll work, but what this gives you is a really nice optimization in terms of resource usage and being able to dynamically scale the workloads that Jenkins. So if you have a really busy Jenkins server, lots of teams developing, continuously pushing to this Jenkins server, this gives you a really flexible way to run your workloads. And an additional benefit, in my opinion, is that you actually give the developers the tools. They can provide the Docker image with all the dependencies that they need to build their application. So there's no more need to have this central Jenkins administrator that you have to ask really nicely, well, I want to use this plugin, can you please install it for me, or something like that. No, you can just say, oh, okay, I want to use this image for my builds, define it in the slave template, and off you go. Some benefits, I guess.
Yeah, what I would like to use it for is do branch building, for instance.
Yeah.
We have a cloud solution which runs on AWS. Our build server is also on AWS, so it would fit nicely in there just to allow us to do different builds per branch. So if someone pushes something to revision on a different branch to build to, because not only we have the master branch, which is actually automatically deployed, but so if someone builds a new feature, you actually want to spin up a different environment, and just be able to show this to your PO, like, hey, look, I made these features, it's okay for merging them.
Yeah, this is really what I had in mind with being able to run multiple versions environments within the same cluster, that you could actually use this for, okay, I want to build this feature branch, I'm going to deploy it on the cluster, and somebody can take a look at it, and then remove it. So this is definitely possible.
It looks very impressive. I was just curious, you mentioned this, I googled it, this Nomad project started in September of last year.
Yeah.
How many people are working on it? I mean, it looks to be quite a big thing, to quite complex.
There are two main developers from HashiCorp working on it full time. I'm sort of contributing to it, but it's in the user experience part and not sort of the hardcore scheduling stuff. And Armon, the CTO of HashiCorp, he actually built out the initial version of the scheduler. But it's now two dedicated developers on it.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
So they have two full-time people in HashiCorp, and you're one of, because I saw you were a core contributor or a core committer or something.
Yeah, right. So I've been contributing to Nomad in terms of usability aspects for the most part, and validation of job configs, stuff like that. And thought it was good enough to make me a committer on the project. So I help out with people who have issues getting Nomad up and running or contributing new features.
Yeah, very impressive. Complex software.
Yeah, it is. In the core, it is really complex. And they actually did a lot of research on how to build this. And like I talked in the beginning about this, the scheduling being done on all servers, they really took this idea from Google Borg papers and Google Omega, so the schedules that are running in Google. They really did their research and sort of implemented all this stuff in Nomad. So it's really quite an impressive engineering feat. Yeah.
So the what HashiCorp does, because if you check it out now, they have like all these awesome fancy tools, Hacker Vault, Console, Nomad, Auto. What they do is they have an idea. They are very present in the infrastructure market. They deal with this stuff. So they say, okay, maybe we need a tool like a scheduling tool. Somebody tests it out. They have the money, right? They have now the economical muscle to do that. They put somebody, normally it's Mitchell, the owner, he just tests an idea, and after a week, says, okay, bitches, here it is, it's working, now make it better. And then his team behind makes it better. Console, Nomad, Vault, name it. It's pretty great. That's why we created the meetup, because we like it.
Yeah. Well, I'm very impressed. It's it's not my area of expertise by a long way, but I mean, that's a really complex bit of software they put together. It's a very small bunch of people, very tight control.
Yeah. How does it compare to Kubernetes? They're not up to multiple data centers, but they will.
I must say, I'm not really that familiar with Kubernetes. I haven't used it myself.
If you really want to do a container-only thing, use Kubernetes. And if you really do need the other features of what Nomad can provide, like jars, VMs, then use Nomad.
But Kubernetes doesn't do anything with cross data centers.
No.
And Nomad
also
does.
The cross-platform. I didn't schedule Explorer browser, but you could also let Nomad schedule that on the Windows platform for you.
Yeah.
It's really flexible in terms of workload. So it has some definite advantages over something like Kubernetes. But like Mon said, if you really want to use the Docker containers, then Kubernetes just as well. It's just a bigger project, more moving parts maybe. So.
Right, so Kubernetes is more focused on Docker containers. So yeah. If you need containers that need to be scheduled together, and then you need to be like, you have to have a set of containers running together and multi-networking happening, all this stuff, Kubernetes has done a lot of work towards this. So it's a drop-in solution for that kind of scenario. But if you're looking to schedule more generic, less Dockerized application, then maybe Nomad is what you're looking for.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's it. All right, well, thank you.